Oi. Hát itt már nagy a készülődés, itt fog megjelenni 17. karmapa. Ő azért 17. karmapa, hiszen 17. reinkarnációja már ennek a léleknek. Önmagának tudja továbbvinni a lelkét, úgyhogy erről is fogom majd őt kérdezni. Most pedig ahol vagyunk, az egy alapkőletétel lesz, egy buddhista centrum. Meg gondolom pedig a különböző buddhista szimbólumokat láthatunk, ezek a szertartásnak nyilván a részei. Nagyon halkan beszélek, mert a mögöttem kezdetét vette a rituálé, és most éppen felolvasnak a szentkönyvből.
A mi egyházunk, egy imántud buddhista közösség, egyike a négy tibeti buddhista vonalnak. A karmakagyu vonalhoz tartozunk, ami egy szóbeli átadási vonalat jelent, ez a magyar államisággal közel egyidős buddhista iskola, aminek az élén a 12. századtól a karmapák állnak. Ők Tibet első tudatosan újra született jógiai, megvalósított tudattal rendelkeznek. Ez az újraszületéses technika, amit alkalmaznak, ez ahhoz segíti hozzá őket, hogy rengeteg tapasztalatot, rengeteg emléket tudnak megőrizni az előző életekből, ami segíti azt, hogy minden lény javára váljanak. Az első tanításokat, amit a gyémántud buddhizmusról kaptunk, azt Lámó Lenidától és a feleségétől, Hanától kaptuk. 1988-ban tanított Lámó Lenidát először Budapesten, és a tanításai, a látásmódja annyira megfogott minket, hogy két meditációs központ létre is jött a tanításainak köszönhetően. Ez Budapesten és Veszprémben alakult meg az első két meditációs központunk.
We came right from a big meeting at Kuhari in Poland, where we had made a big thing, you know, and everywhere I'd gone from Scandinavia and all the way down to Greece, you know, and Italy and so on, everywhere, you know, I was the first one starting the things, right? And then I came over the border into Hungary, and the first thing I see is an enormous stupa and everything like that. So I said, wow, you know, somebody has been here before. And that was, of course, Alexander Tschudis and his work and all the other things, right? So this was very impressive.
Ennek a meditációs központnak a további építését kezdenénk el most nyáron. Június 26-án volt az ünnepélyes alapkőletétel, ahol a 17. gyalva karmapa és Lámó Lenidát közösen helyeztek el az időkapszulába bizonyos dolgokat, amelyek reprezentálják a közösségünket, az aktivitásunkat és a maradandó tanításokat.
Vége van az ünnepélyek, és találkoztam Dórival, aki kicsit segíteni fog nekem itt körbevezetni az egész épületbe.
Ez a pesti centrumunk, de hát az ország területén több.
Van több is el?
Igen. Nagyon jó az, amikor ugye egy adott mozgalmas napunk után bejövünk, és akkor itt találkozunk a barátainkkal, és akkor közösen meditálunk, és aztán minden annyira tett közössé és családiassá alakul. Tök érdekes egyébként, hogy figyelnek. Húzod magadnak, hogy szemben figyelj, koncentráltabb vagy.
Igen.
Ennyi.
Mindig ezen gondolkoztam, a meditációban nagyon sokat, nem mondom, nagyon sokat hallottam róla, de azért hallottam már róla, hogy ez gyakorlatilag akárki, tehát aki nem buddhista, ő is meditál.
Abszolút. Szerintem egyetlen fontos dolog a nyitottság.
Gyakorlatilag mondhatjuk, hogy ez egy gyógyír is lehet a dolgokra.
Mindjárt dolgozunk, tehát teljes életet élünk, nem arról van szó, hogy elvonultan ide bejövünk és egész 24 órán keresztül meditálunk. Lehet ezt is választani, aki ezt szeretné, de én azt gondolom, hogy ebben a társadalomban, amiben élünk, szeretnénk teljes emberek lenni és akár példaként is szolgálni.
Well, actually, the Karmapa is the first incarnate Lama of Tibet back from 1110. And that was his first, and he gained the name of Dusum Chempa, meditating, you know, in the eastern Tibet. Dusum Chempa, Du means time, Sum means three, and Chempa means knower, the one who knows past, present, and future. So he was highly intuitive, right? You can say. He died in 1193, became 83 years old, and then he left a letter saying where he would be reborn. And then they went and they found a small child who had all the different signs, who could recognize the people from his last life and so on. And in this way the Karmapas have been moving up till today, where we have the 17th here. But actually the Karmapas were smart enough, I would say, to stay out of politics, right? Because that destroys most holy things, right?
Mindig nagyon különleges a tudatunk valódi természetével találkozni. És Karmapa ő egy megvilágosodott személy, egy élő buddha, hogy szokták nevezni. A jógi királya, hogy Tibetben hívják. A vele való találkozás mindig rengeteg értékes benyomást hagy a tudatban. Ezért nagyon fontos a vele való találkozás során koncentrálnunk arra, amit tanít, odafigyelni, tudatosan odafigyelni arra, amit kaphatunk tőle.
Sok várakozás után végre bejutottunk ide a terembe, és most sok fiatal fog beszélgetni magával, Karmapával, úgyhogy le is ülök és várom őt. I was wondering that do you have a Facebook account or what you think about it?
Ah, yes. I have a Facebook account, which is open for all. But I don't really manage it myself. There's a difficulty of time, you know, to manage all that.
Do you think it's a waste of time?
I don't think it's a waste of time. But if you have the right intention, it could not be a waste of time. It could be something positive. Yeah. Nice hair. I cannot have that kind of hair. I'm banned.
Több mint 10 év telt el azóta, hogy először volt Magyarországon. Most már egy felnőtt emberrel találkozunk, 29 éves. Egyrészt külső szinten egy erős férfi emberrel találkozhatunk. Most már angolul tanít, ami megkönnyíti a kommunikációt, a kicserélődést vele. Ugyanakkor látszik az, hogy a kulturális különbségek, ami nyugat és kelet között vannak, azokat teljesen át tudta hidalni.
My software version is 101. Like everybody, the same potential, like everybody. A potential where I can be totally free, yes. But I have a long way to go to reach into the absolute or obsolete version of the software, yes. My hardware would change from time to time, you know. Sometimes it's Mac, sometimes it's PC.
Nagyon jól érti a nyugati gondolkodást, nagyon jól átvette azokat a módszereket, amivel itt nyugaton közvetlen módon lehet tanítani. Az első évektől kezdve folyamatosan Lámoléval együtt utazott. Ez lehetőséget biztosított arra, hogy lássa, hogy milyen módon dolgozik a nyugati tudat, lehetőséget biztosított számára is arra, hogy megnézze, hogy hogyan működnek a centrumaink. Erre, mint alapra tudta építeni ezt a maradandó és nem változó látásmódot.
We have four schools of Tibetan Buddhism. We have three old schools that mainly focus on meditation and are not so interested in politics. And then we have a new school, the Gelugpa school, the Dalai Lama, who do the politics and everything. So the three old schools are known by their red hats, and the new school is known by their yellow hat.
The way children are brought up in Tibet is very different from the rest of the world. If there are signs or indications that your child, you know, is somehow a little bit unique, then there is special care. So therefore, in some ways, I could say that no, I didn't have any part of my life growing as any other, you know, children would go through. When I was very small, I was extremely naughty. I was extremely tough, very, very tough to handle. Unfortunately, my father being away for some time, it was all left for my mother to really, you know, experience all of that. So she said that it was quite a challenge. So therefore, I believe I was quite unique in some perspective from other child. Yes, I was very calm, you know, composed, you know, very cute and loving child. Then I was recognized. Later, whom I found out was my teacher, recognized me as the reincarnation of my predecessor. It was at the time a very numb experience. Yeah. No particular joy, no particular sadness, just numb.
We had been out there two times earlier in 68, and then in 69, 2 days before Christmas, we came driving an old Volkswagen bus all the way out from Central Europe, right? We climbed up the Swayambhu, the very big stupa outside Kathmandu, and we just ran up there, and there were 1,000 Tibetans, you know, just squeezed in. And we were standing there, and we looked up. At that moment, he put his hands on our heads and he became bigger than the whole sky, you know, and he was shining like 100 suns, you know, he's very powerful. And we were completely in shock, and he lifted us, and people pushed us here to get a string around our necks, there to get something to drink, there something to eat. And then they gradually let us out. And then afterwards, we were holding on to this thing and looking at him, and he blessed the last people. Then we wouldn't leave, right? We were just sitting there, you know, and apparently he looked out and said, those guys, you know what? So the doctor, they had one man who spoke English. He was Urjan Jigme was his name. And when he came down then and gave us a little package and in paper, just a little folded paper package, you know. And then I put that in my left pocket, and then on the way back through Kathmandu in the evening, and I felt it burned, and at that time I smoked a pipe, so I thought maybe it was burning my shirt, right? So I took it out, and there was nothing but burned, put it in the other side, and then that burned, right? And like this we came back. And in the end, when when I took off the shirt, I really screamed, you know, which I usually don't do, because it was like fire in the body. Then we had a container made, and that is what we have, what I have here. It's filled by Karmapa himself, you see.
Azt hallottam, hogy videójátékokkal is szokott játszani.
Favorite game so far is Assassin's Creed. Because I can really explore the whole cities, the architecture. It's important, yeah, to keep up with what is happening. Otherwise, no matter how spiritual you are, if you don't know what's happening today. Favorite, well, of all time, Star Wars, yes. And the Lord of the Rings. Yes. Enlightenment is either pointless, because once you reach there, then it's a path where you give up everything. You try to see that everything is pointless, and so you distract, you distance yourself from what is really, really happening. And so therefore you develop some kind of numbness, you know, a state of numbness. That's also not the case, I think. And some might also say that it's a way to develop, let's say, a lot of happiness, you know, a lot of happy experiences. But what it really is a state of mind where we can develop complete understanding of how things are and of how things function. And if you have that, then you will not be distracted by not knowing certain things. All knowledge will be transparent and complete for us, and so they will be able to, therefore we will be able to be completely beneficial for others. And anyway, that's my limited definition.
Lenyűgöző volt. Egyszerűen ez a lazaság, ez valami hihetetlen volt.
Erőteljes és meggyőző.
Abszolút mindenkinek átment. 40 fokon is. Nagyjából bármilyen életet.
Azzal, hogy a trónról leszállt, csak néhány lépcsőfok, de valójában egy kulturális szakadékot ugrott át.
Összentsége 17. alap nem csak Budapestre látogatott ez alkalommal, hanem eljött a meditációs elvonási központunkban Nógrád megyébe, Becskére. Itt 98 óta működtetünk egy elvonási központot. Nyaranta itt szoktuk megrendezni a nemzetközi meditációs kurzusainkat, ahova több száz ember, most jelen esetben valószínűleg több ezer ember látogat el. És itt valójában 2008-ban sikerült felépítenünk egy mögöttem látható megvilágosodás stupát, Serap Gyalcsa Rinpoche vezetésével és Lámon Nidál támogatásával.
What would be your message to the young people who is taking drugs and who is in a bad way?
Many of us wants to experience everything, you know, get a first-hand experience of what is what. On that basis, there's not much to say. One cannot change that, or one cannot stop that. Sometimes trying to stop it might lead to even worse cases. But what I really do hope is that through their experience, they will be able to see how unnecessary it is, how unbeneficial it is for oneself and for others. But I think to be able to do that, maybe sometimes for some individuals, might need to have first-hand experience. Without it, they will never know. Same case, if you say, is drug good or bad? A professor or an expert could talk about so many things of how bad it is, but you will never know how bad it is until you really have an experience. That doesn't mean that somebody, not everybody, should go and start having experiences, of course. but yeah, it's somehow, that's the irony of life in sometimes, that you have to go through certain experiences. If you can get away from it, you are very fortunate. Otherwise, you have to have some experiences, or whether it's good or bad. Otherwise, we don't know.
Az első európai túrájának, ami Düsseldorfba kezdődött, annak voltunk mi is a részesei Budapesten. Egyébként ezt követően Münchenben adott még tanítást, és talán Bécsben. Azt követően volt 2004-ben és 2005-ben, akkor már a Huszár utcai meditációs központunkban tudtuk őt vendégül látni, és most van itt először Becskén úgy, hogy már látja a 2008-ban épült megvilágosodás stupát.
Of course it's Europe-wide, it is Europe-wide, but percentage-wise you are doing very well, really. There is a great interest, there's a great openness, you know, you have some feeling that a lot of you and your language especially came originally from the Far East, you know, Attila and his people and so on, that they were here, right? And Budapest and the name and so on, all these things remind you that you have strong roots in the Central Asia, right, like that. So these things, of course, interest people, but also you are what the English said about Tibetan. You are jolly and fearless, joyful and fearless, right? And that's also what they say about the Danes, by the way, right? And that is a very special quality. And if you are that, then you don't want a religion where people tell you what to believe. You want a religion where you get methods in order to experience how things are inside and outside and so on. And also because of your very independent way of thinking.
We could say that we are all materialistic, the thing is. If you don't somehow step forward and to find a balance and to see, is there more than materialistic value in life or not? If you don't do that, it's the same everywhere around the world. It's not just the West, but it's materialistic. Even in the East, very materialistic. Maybe we could ask ourselves, how did we become so materialistic? And also, is this materialistic really, really that bad after all? Yeah. Because, for example, like medicine, science, economy, all of this, actually, from a Buddhist perspective, is neither good nor bad. It's the intention of the individuals that makes it either good or bad. That's the funny thing. If you have a good intention, we can use it for hydropower or whatever electricity power, and not exactly, you know, cause any problems. But if you have the wrong intention, then we could use it for war. There are tons of solutions, no matter how late we are. Past is past. Only a memory is there. Yes, there are certain effects that we experience right now in the present moment due to the past, but it's past. It can never ever come back. Buddha, Jesus, whoever, no matter how powerful they are, Indra, Brahman, no one can bring it back. No one. Similarly for the future. No one can tell you how it's going to be. Yeah. We can only assume. So instead, what's the point of worrying about that? Instead, we try to live as harmonious, as fearless, as doubtless as we can every day. Day is too long, from moment to moment. She just clicked, and the first click is gone. Now we can only experience maybe a moment of click less or click, you know. And then when that happens, we have the choice of whether producing a kind of thought about it, or no thought about it, or a negative thought about it. That's it. So we have the choice. We have the freedom to decide what we want to do. And that'll affect so much. This is not a revolution.
This is just a conversation.